So you had 30 minutes and I think six passages with a total of 50 questions. How many of these passages were you able to solve? That's good, man. If you have found this passage familiar, that means you are practicing, which is good. And it's also good that you remember the answers to these questions. Right? If you remember the answers to these questions, then that is excellent. Okay. So guys, how many of these six passages were you able to solve? Out of the six passages, how many of them were we able to solve? Sakshi says three. Okay, fair enough. What about the others? That means on an average, you took 10 minutes per passage, reading the passage and solving the questions. Okay, that's fine. What about the others? Three. Okay. On an average, three. Surely I managed to go up to four. Okay, not bad. Fine. So on an average, I think you are able to solve three passages out of the six. So what I'm going to do is we will discuss the three passages, right? Then I will give you the answer key to the remaining three passages, but I want you to solve the other three passages at your own time once the class is over, right? Whenever you get time, I want you to take out half an hour and solve the fourth, fifth, and sixth passage also, and then check how many of those answers you got right. Correct? So today, because most of us have done three passages, I'm going to solve the first three passages. Right? So let's take passage number one. It is about the employment opportunities for minority communities. Right? Okay. Rehani is asking how much time will we have per passage? See, per passage, they don't give you specific time. It's not time bound in most exams, right? You generally are allowed to take as much time as you want moving between the sections. But if these are the size of the passages and these many questions are there, I would recommend on an average 8 minutes per passage, right? If you can do it faster, very good. 8, maximum 9 minutes. If you can read the passage and solve the questions, then that is good enough, right? But you don't have restriction of time on per question, right? Section-wise, some exams may have a restriction, but most of them don't have a restriction for every question. You are allowed to have as many question time you need per question. But on an average, for a passage of this difficulty and this size, I would recommend 8 to 9 minutes. Chalo. The first passage. Did everybody understand the first passage? Or was there any part of the passage that you would like me to explain? Were you able to understand the first passage? Guys, were you able to understand the first passage? Okay, any part of the passage which requires explanation, any word or any part of the passage which you felt you did not understand and you want an explanation for? Okay, so if you have understood the entire passage, then what we are going to do is I'll take you through the questions and what their answer should be, and then we can see from there, right? So what was the very first question in this particular passage? Let's take a look at it. The first question was the primary purpose of this passage. What is the primary purpose of this passage? Does it present a commonplace idea and the inaccuracies in that idea? No, it does not tell you a common idea, right? It is not something which is regular. Does it describe a situation and its potential drawbacks? Drawbacks means problems. Well, in the beginning, it talks about the minority community employment opportunities, and the second half talks about the various ways in which this can be exploited. So B could be my answer. C, propose a temporary solution to the problem. It is not talking about any solutions. It is not analyzing any disagreement, and it is not exploring the implication of any finding, right? It is simply talking about a situation, and it is talking what are the drawbacks, what are the problems in this situation. So the answer to the first question is definitely B. The answer to the first question is definitely B. I think this was relatively easy. The second one. The passage supplies information which would answer which of the following questions, right? if you have read the passage, then which question from these five will you be able to answer? Okay. What federal agencies have set percentage goals for the use of minority-owned businesses in public work contracts? It does not talk about a federal agency that is setting any goals. To which government agency must business awarded federal contract report the efforts? Right? It does not tell which agency they must report it to. They are reporting, but to whom? Not given. How widespread is the use of minority-owned concerns as fronts by white backers? Even this is not answered. How many more minority-owned businesses were there in 1977 than 72? Well, this is also not answered. What is the one set of conditions under which a small business might find itself financially overextended? Well, if you take a look at the passage carefully, then the conditions under which the small business might find itself financially overextended is clearly given. So the answer to the second question is definitely E, right? Sakshi got it right. I hope the others also understood. The answer to the second question is definitely E. Did you get that? Okay. Now, moving on to the third one. According to the passage, civil rights activists maintain that one disadvantage under which minority-owned businesses have traditionally had to labor is what? It is not the government mismanagement of the economy is not discussed. It is not discussed that they're being denied bank loans at rates comparable, right? Nothing about advertisement and nothing about representation of government power. But the passage definitely tells that whatever businesses is created by large corporations, the minority owned businesses could not secure these businesses. So definitely the third one is C, right? Answer to the third one is definitely C. Sakshi got this one. Very good. Did the others also get this one? The answer to the third one is C. Good. Fourth, the passage suggests that the failure of a large business to have its bids for subcontract results quickly in orders, which might cause it to what? If the failure of a large business to have its bid for subcontract happens, what happens? It will experience frustration but not serious financial harm. That is definitely true, right? For the fourth one, A, the very first option itself is my answer. None of the other options make any sense. So for the fourth one, A is definitely the answer. For the fifth one, the author implies that a minority-owned concern that does the greater part of its business with one large corporate customer should what? A minority-owned concern that does greater part of business with one large corporate customer, right? Even without looking at the options, common sense says that if you are doing business only with one customer, that is dangerous. You must always try to find more customers so that you don't become dependent on just one corporation. So logically also, C definitely my answer to this one. Right? So the third one was C. The first is B. For second, E. For the third, C. For the fourth, A. And the fifth one, this one is C. Right? The fifth one, this one is C. I think so far the questions are pretty simple. Sixth, it can be inferred from the passage that compared with the requirement of law, the percentage goals set by some federal and local agencies, what? Compared with the requirement of law, the percentage goals which are set by some federal and local agencies, they are definitely more specific, right? They are definitely more specific. Nothing to do with expense, ease of compliance, controversy or popular. It simply says that these things are more specific. So the sixth one, we are looking at option B. Seventh one, which of the following, if true, would weaken the author's assertion that in the 1970s, corporate response to federal requirement was substantial? The author is saying that during the 1970s, whatever was federal requirement, whatever the federal government said is compulsory, the corporate response was huge. Substantial means large. What you have to do? You have to say which option weakens this argument, right? So which option says that this was not the case? Now, can I say corporate contracts with minority owned businesses totaled 2 billion in 1979? If that business was 2 billion in 1979, how is it weakening the argument that the corporate response was substantial? I don't know, right? So A doesn't help me too much. Between 1970 and 72, corporate contracts with minority owned business declined by 25%, okay? But even if the response went down, whatever was the response could still be large, right? If I'm earning 1 crore and my salary reduces by 25%, earning 0.75 crores is still substantial, right? So I cannot say that decline by 25% itself is actually indicating that the response was not substantial. So B, I'll keep it for the time being, right? Not very convinced with B. C, the figure collected in 1977 underrepresented the extent of corporate contracts. If 1977 figure is actually underrepresenting, that means the figure is much larger. So that is saying it is much larger means it is actually more substantial. I have to say less substantial. So C, definitely not my answer. D says, the estimate of corporate spending with minority owned businesses in 1980 is approximately 10 million too high. Okay, but it is not giving me a base. If I'm saying it is 200 and it is, if I'm estimating that it is 200 million and the actual figure is only 190 million, but 190 is also a substantial figure. So even if the real figure is 10 million less, that does not mean it is not substantial. So D, not necessarily my answer. Chalo. The 1.1 billion represented the same percentage of total corporate spending in 77 as did 77 million in 1972, right? If the percentage of 1.1 billion is the same, then it does not mean they're actually spending more. They are spending the same percentage, right? That says it, the 1.1 billion figure looks as if it is an improvement over 77 million. But the point is, if I'm spending 5 rupees out of 100 or I'm spending 25 rupees out of 500, my percentage of spending has not increased. So just because 1.1 billion alone is larger than millions does not mean that it has become larger. Just because 1.1 billion is a big figure compared to a few millions does not mean it is a larger figure, because you have to see it as a percentage. So if 1.1 billion is the same percentage to total as this million, that means the increase is not substantial. So for the seventh one, E is actually a good answer. Don't be fooled by the figure. Look at the percentage, right? It is like saying one person scored 10 marks in the test. The other person scored 50 marks in the test. Whose performance was better? If one student got 10 marks in a test, another student got 50 marks in a test, who performed better? I can't say, because if the first person got 10 out of 10 and the second person got 50 out of 100, obviously the first student actually performed better. So E is a good answer to the seventh one. Did everybody understand this? E is actually a good answer to this particular question. Did you get it? Okay. Last question of this set. The author would most likely agree with which of the following statements about corporate response to working with minority subcontractors? You have to answer which one the author is likely to agree with. Now, annoyed by the proliferation, proliferation means increase. Annoyed with the proliferation of front organizations, corporations are likely to reduce their effort to work with minority-owned subcontractors. No, the corporations don't have any problem with the fronts, right? It is a matter of governance, but companies themselves don't have any problem with fronts. Although corporations showed considerable interest in working with minority business in the 70s, their aversion to government paperwork made them reluctant to pursue many government contracts. Nothing is mentioned about the paperwork in the passage. Irrelevant answer. The significant response of corporations in the 70s is likely to be sustained and conceivably be increased throughout the 80s. Possible. Although corporations are eager to cooperate with minority-owned business, shortage of capital in the 70s made substantial response impossible. Nothing about shortage of capital. The enormous corporate response has all but eliminated danger of overexpansion. There is nothing about overexpansion. So, the only thing which reasonably the author may agree with is C. So, the answers that we are looking for in the first one are as follows. How many of these could you get right? How many of these answers did we get right? 5, 7, 6. Okay, good. Only one wrong. Very good. Okay. Minimum 5 everybody is getting. On an average, 6 to 7. Right? Minimum 5 everybody has got. Very good. So I hope now, if you got any of them wrong, now that you know the answer, go back to the passage once the class is done. Right? Whenever you are doing any RC, in fact, any type of question, any exercise in any subject, once you have done it, once you have checked it, you must always go back to the questions with the answer in hand and check the answers that you got wrong. And then when you know the answer and then when you read the question and try to solve it, automatically you will understand what mistake you could have been making. Right? So 5 of them, it's an average score, right? Because this is relatively an easy passage. You could have got at least 1 or 2 marks, right? So just go back and see where you are making the mistakes. And next time onwards, if this passage comes, you should be able to score much higher, right? Okay. Second passage. Now, I believe the second passage was somewhat confusing. At least the concept in the beginning was not very easy to understand. Once you, if you manage to survive the first couple of paragraphs, then the concept near the end was somewhat okay. But the passage by itself was not an easy to understand passage. Right? Okay, Sakshi skipped it. Fair enough. I would have done the same thing in the exam. Once I read the first para, if I don't understand, I will not waste time. I will go ahead to the next passage. I will come back to this passage after I have attempted all the other ones. But I will not stick with this passage in the middle of the paper. Too much of a time waster. That's a good strategy to have, Sakshi. When you don't understand the beginning of the passage, it's quite possible that the entire passage may be tough. So rather than waste time, you should always skip to the next question, next passage or next question. And then once all the others are solved, then you can come back to it. But don't waste time in the middle of the passage. Right? So Hriday, like I said, these passages, they are about 8 to 9 minutes per passage, including answering the questions. 8 to 9 minutes reading the passage and answering the questions. That's the time that it should take. Okay. Chalo. Let's take a look at the pa- okay this passage is about, it starts with Woodrow Wilson, right? US president. It starts with Woodrow Wilson, and it talks about economic systems, right? What it means to be free, what is meant by freedom in the economic system, and what it means to be self-employed in the economic system, and what it means to, what is the definition of stability, right? It talks about all these things. So it talks about the economic systems in terms of US, but for some years back, right? It talks Woodrow Wilson's no pride in being an employee. You should be an employer. It talks about self-employment and stuff like that. Okay. So, starting with the questions. The first one, what was the primary purpose of this passage? Right? Like I clearly said, it is about the American economic mythology. Right? What people thought it should be like and what is the reality. That is what they're comparing. Right? It is not a comparison between old and new or about political leaders, or it is not talking about the neglected Americans, and it is not definitely suggesting any substitute. In fact, it is very clearly criticizing what was wrong with the American economic mythology. So the first one, definitely my answer is A. In the second one, now this, if you are able to find out where it refers to old world, then you will be able to understand what they are referring to, right? So according to the passage, what is meant by old world values were based on what, right? In somewhat the initial parts of the passage, it mentions that old world values were based on property. I think that is very clear in the passage. Right? You don't even have to understand much because very clearly it is given that initially the values were based upon property and now the values are based on what? If I show you where it is in the passage, right? In the beginning, the old world categories of settled possessiveness versus unsettling deprivation, blah, 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 retention, blah, 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 blah. We did not base our system on property, but opportunity. So old world was on property. The new world is on opportunity, right? It's given in the very first line, very first few lines. So that is the answer that we are looking for. So the first one was A. Answer to the second one is B. Okay. Third question. In the context of the author's discussion of regulating change, which of the following could be most probably regarded as a strong referee? And here very clearly they have given you where to look for this, right? It says near line 30, and the numbers are clearly given. So all you had to do was scroll to that part of the passage. So a strong referee refers to what? And there you will be able to find out. It's the federal court judge. So if I go back to the passage around line 30, right? The non-starters were considered the ones who wanted stability. A strong referee to give them some position in the race. A regulative hand to calm manic speculation. An authority that can call things to a halt. Right? So, who is the person who can calm people and yet has the authority to do things? A principal, a political theory worker, a social worker, or an inspector can't do these things. The authority is only there with the federal court judge, right? So the best answer is definitely a federal court judge in this case. Moving on to the next one. The author sets off the word reform, line 35, with quotation marks. Why does he put the word reform in line 35? Let's see line 35, right? Line 35 begins, reform in America has been sterile. So here you can clearly see that he's using these quotation marks. So the point is, why is he putting the word reform in quotation marks? So I think whenever we put something in quotation marks, what are we trying to do? Right? Assert that reform is not fundamental. Right? Reform. Hum kisi cheez ko sarcastically jab bolte hain, He said he's a very nice boy. So if I put quote marks around nice, I actually mean that he's not nice. If I say this is a quote unquote easy exam, right? Whenever a word is put in quotations, that means we are actually meaning that it is not. So the word reform, when it is in quotations, it means it is not actually fundamental, right? He's sarcastically referring to it. Fifth one, it can be inferred from the passage that the author most probably thinks that giving the disenfranchised a piece of action is what, right? Giving the disenfranchised means those who don't have opportunities, those who are backward, those who have not been given a chance, right? The oppressed people. So when the author says that giving the disenfranchised a piece of action, what he means is it's an example of Americans' resistance to profound social change, right? Just give them thoda lollipop, but they are against totally changing the system. That is what he means. So fifth one, B is my answer. Sixth one, which of the following metaphors could the author most probably use to summarize his own assessment of the American economic system, right? Chalte jao, lekin kahin pe na pahuncho. The entire point, the passage is, you keep doing a lot of hard work, but you don't reach anywhere. And that happens on a treadmill. What you also call a walker, right? Gym mein hota hai na. Us pe aap chalte jaoge, lekin ek hi jagah pe khade ho. So you are doing a lot of effort, but you're not going anywhere. That is what the passage also says. So, the metaphor that the author will best use will be a treadmill. You do a lot of things, but it does not give you any outcome. You just spend a lot of energy on this, right? So the answers for 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 and 6 so far, A, B, C, E, B and C. These are the answers so far, guys. These are the answers so far. Right, Param? Very quiet today. Usually I get Param answering a lot of questions. Right, we are still left with certain questions. Guys, abhi aur three questions baki hai is set ke. Chalo, let's take a look at the remaining last three. It can be inferred from the passage that Woodrow Wilson's idea about the economic market, it perpetuated legends about America. What Woodrow Wilson thought, whatever Woodrow Wilson's opinions were, it spread the myth about America. Traditionally, what people used to think about America, Woodrow Wilson's ideas, it helped propagate that. The passage contains information that would answer which of the following questions. So, has the economic policy in US tended to reward independent action is the only question which it answers. Right? So the eighth one is definitely C. And the ninth last question of this set, I know, stupid difficult set, let's just do it. Which of the following best expresses the author's main point? The author's main point is that the myth of American free enterprise is seriously flawed. What people think, right? It is all mythical. It is actually problematic. The entire passage, in fact, in multiple questions, we get to understand this. Even in the previous question, right? Whatever people think about the American system, there's a serious problem with it. There's a serious flaw in that. So, tough passage, although surprisingly questions were not that difficult, but still reading and understanding the passage itself may have taken some time. So not very high scoring passage. Getting 4 or 5 out of 9 would have been okay. You could have taken 10 to 11 minutes to solve this one. This would have taken some time, and getting 4 or 5 out of the 9 is okay. It's not a great score, but nevertheless, if you have solved it, then this score is good enough. If you have skipped it, even that is acceptable. because the initial passage, initial part of the passage was very, very metaphorical. Understanding it would take a lot of time. You cannot quickly read it and understand it. It has to be slowly read a couple of times, which the time we do not have much in the exam. Right? Hriday, 6. Okay, good. Fair enough. That's fair enough. Okay. Moving on to the third passage, the last passage which most of us were able to complete today, right? And a very, very technical passage. Passage 3. It's about geology. It's about motion of the ocean basins and movement of currents and stuff like that. Yes, Hriday. So, if it took a lot of time, this should be a clear indicator that we should never solve long passages in the middle of the paper. Because if you waste a lot of time in this and we run out of time, that means you might miss out on easier questions. In such passages, it will take a lot of time and you are not going to score heavily. So always maximize your score in the paper. The strategy of any entrance exam is always to maximize your score. So whenever you see that a passage is large, when you read the first couple of lines and you find it to be difficult to understand, don't sit and waste your time on it. Move on to the other sections. And at the end, when you have completed maximizing scores through easy questions, then come back to this passage and answer it, right? This passage was purposely given for that. As practice, fair enough. But in the exam, not to be done in the middle. Chalo, let's take a look at this one. This passage clearly talks about all technical things, right? Geology and blah, 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 blah. First one. According to the traditional view of the origin of ocean basins, which of the following is sufficient to move the continental plates? Right? If you read the passage carefully and find where it talks about the traditional view, it just talks about difference in temperature. I think close to sentences 10 and 11. Look at near lines 10 and 11. If you take a look at sentences 10 and 11, there you will find the traditional view ke bare mein kya bolte hain, aspas. Sorry, traditional view is near, in fact, the beginning, near sentence 3 itself, it starts traditional view. Sentence 3 itself starts near traditional view. Okay. So first one is E. Second one, it can be inferred from the passage that of the following, the deepest sediments, where will it be found? The deepest sediments, I think clearly you will be able to answer this. It is the Black Sea. The deepest sediments, where will it be found? Black Sea. Moving ahead, third one. The author refers to conveyor belt in line 13. In line 13, he says this convection would carry the continental plates along as though they were on a conveyor belt and would provide the forces needed. So when he uses conveyor belt, what is he trying to say? He's only showing the effect of convection in the mantle. So clearly, third one is A. Clearly, third one is A. Fourth, the author regards traditional view of the origin of ocean with what? When he talks about the traditional view about how the oceans originated, what is his opinion? He is not very convinced by it, right? He doesn't say outright that it is wrong, but he points out a lot of errors in it. So it is called guarded skepticism. He's very careful in saying that it may be wrong, right? He's not angry. He's not indifferent. He's not disbelieving it, but he does not believe, right? He doubts it. Skepticism is doubt. And he's careful about doubting it. He's not openly doubting it. It's not complete. It is careful. So guarded skepticism is what the option should be. Fourth ka E. Fifth, according to the passage, which of the following are separated by a plate that is growing on both sides? Right? This is factual. You just need to read the passage and identify which of these are separated by a plate growing on both the sides. You will clearly find the answer in this case, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge and the Indian Ocean Ridge. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge and the Indian Ocean Ridge. This is just reading the passage and finding out. There's no analysis to be done. This is a factual statement which you need to find out directly given in the passage. All you have to do is find out where it is given in the passage. Next, seventh one. According to the passage, the floor of the Black Sea can best be compared to what? The floor of the Black Sea can best be compared to what? A slowly settling foundation. A slowly settling foundation. And which of the following title would best describe the content of the passage? Right? He's talking about the old conventional theory and a new theory. So these are the different theories that he's talking about. So definitely B is my answer. Right? So this passage relatively technical, but still easy because a lot of factual questions were asked from this passage. So how many of these were we able to solve? In this passage, how many of the questions were we able to solve? Six of them, seven of them. Okay. Not bad at all. Okay. So guys, you are able to solve only the first three passages. A majority of you, some of you were able to do the fourth one as well. But a majority have not done the fourth passage onwards. So I'm giving the fourth, fifth and sixth passage for today as homework. I'll send the answer key on WhatsApp so that you can check the answers, right? So today's session, the first three we discussed, any doubts in that, any questions in that? No? Okay. Fine. Some of the students informed me that they are having interviews with some colleges. Is there anybody in this back? Okay. Arushi is asking, what is the meaning of flawed? Flaw means mistake. So flawed means anything which has a mistake or an error in it. So when they say this theory is flawed, it means there is some mistake in it. He was full of flaws. Flaws means mistakes. So a flawed object means an object which has a mistake in it or an error in it. Do you get that? Okay. Any other word that you would like to understand, guys? Any word from the three passages that you would like to understand? Either you can ask now or definitely look up those words in the dictionary. Okay. So like I was asking, does anybody have any interview coming up? Hituj has Christ test on 10th. Okay. Okay. So that would be followed by an interview, right, Hituj? Okay. Anyone else appearing for Christ or any other exam which also is followed by an interview? No one else. Only Hituj is giving Christ. Okay. Fine, guys. So because we are done. So if you don't have any doubts right now, then you may exit the session. Hetu, just wait around. I'll talk about interviews today. You guys, if anybody's interested in just knowing how to prepare for interviews, you can stay in the session. If you're not preparing for any interview, then we are done for the day. You may exit the session. Sakshi, okay. So you will be giving an interview. So wait, Shaurya. Yes. So I'll spend about just a few minutes in telling you how you should start preparing for these interviews. We will be having a full-length session, but just to give you a head start, I'll just talk a little bit about interviews right now. So whoever is interested can stay back, right? It won't take much time. If you don't have any interviews, then you may exit the session. For the others, I'll just give you tips on how to start preparing for interviews so that when the proper session comes, it will be easy. Sakshi, you want to write an application essay? Okay, what we do is the colleges generally give you a guideline on what they expect. So what I would suggest is write an application in your own words, write an essay in your own words, send it to me on the WhatsApp number. That is the number from which you get the message every day, right? Just send your essay to me. I'll make the corrections and send it back to you, right? I can make suggestions on what corrections to make in that. So just send me. IHM, no. As far as hotel management IHMs are concerned, under NCHMCT, they do not have any interviews. You just have to give the written exam, which is followed by a counseling, which is basically selection of the institute. They don't have a interview process in the IHMs. Okay. So guys, those who are going to prepare for interviews, I'm just going to take some time in telling you how to prepare for interviews. I'm just going to tell you what interviews are, what you can expect, and that will also help you in the preparation, right? So let's first quickly understand what exactly is an interview and then how we go about preparing for it. So an interview, many people are afraid of that, especially students. When they hear the word interview, they get frightened. Okay, they will ask us questions and what will happen. But remember, an interview is actually a two-party process, right? There are two persons involved. One is obviously you as the student, and the other person is the interviewer who is representing the institute, right? Whichever college your interview are giving, they actually represent the institute. So if you have the pressure of performing well because you have to get selected, the interviewer also has a pressure of selecting the right candidate. If they select the wrong candidate who will not fit with the college, then there is a big problem. So don't think that only you are in the pressure. Even the interviewer has to take care of a lot of things to know whether you are right for that college or not. So if you clear an interview, it only means that you possess the qualities which they are looking for. And if you don't clear an interview, it does not mean that you are bad. It simply means that what qualities you have is not exactly what they are looking for, right? You do not match the college. That is the only thing. So the first and most important thing that you should definitely be doing whenever you are preparing for any particular interview is to know the institute, right? If you are applying for Christ and you are going to sit for the interview of Christ, then you must find out everything that you can about the college. If you are sitting for Ahmedabad University interview, then definitely you should find out more about Ahmedabad University. So in short, you must do research about the college, and the best place to find out any information is the official website of the college itself. So go to the official website of the college, find out everything about them. It is generally given in something known as the About Us page. So read the About Us page in detail, find out information about their course, especially the course in which you are going to apply. Right? Then once you have done this, there are two or three very, very important questions that you must prepare, because most of the interviewers, they definitely ask these things. So first and most important thing, you must know about yourself. If somebody asks you, tell me something about yourself, what will you tell them which helps them select you for the college? Do you think telling about your family will impress them enough to select for the college? Or do you think talking about your school education is going to select you for the college? Or do you think talking about your extra curricular activities will help your selection? So always remember, whenever you answer the question, tell me something about yourself. Keep in mind, whatever I tell them, it should help them in selecting me. They should know such things about me that they feel this person is worth selecting. The second question that you must be prepared with is, why do you want to do this particular course and why do you want to join this particular college? Right? If you are applying for a BBA program, you must know why you want to get into management. If you are planning to apply for law, you must know why you want to do law. If you are applying for hotel management, you should know why you want to do hotel management. And it should not be a lalupanju answer. It should be such an answer that the other person knows that you are a serious candidate who has seriously thought about it. Right? So start thinking why you want to join this particular course. Also, why do you want to join this college? If you are applying for the interview of Christ and the interviewer asks, why do you want to join Christ? You cannot say because this is the best college. Aisa random answer nahi de sakte. Right? Because ye to koi bhi bol dega. You have to know specific things about the college which is good for you. Right? You should be able to answer, sir, Christ is well known for a management program since the year blah blah blah. Christ has very good program with tie-ups with other universities. Such information which is specific, you can always find on their website. So when you do research about the college, try to find out at least 3 points about the college which is unique, useful to you, and which helps you select it. Just like they want to select you, you also want to select a college for a specific reason. So from their website, try to identify at least 3 good things about the college which you find attractive. Right? So about yourself, why this particular course, why this particular college? And third, a connecting question, what qualities do you have which will help your selection? Why should we select you? Many a times they will ask, right? Why should we select you? So then in that case, you should be able to match your qualities with what the college represents, right? So do your homework about the college, do your homework about yourself. And apart from that, there are many other questions, but these are always the 3 main questions which you should be ready with, right? I will request Firdaus sir to take a detailed session so that you can know what to answer, but you can always start doing your homework about these colleges so that when the time comes, you will be ready with the answers. Okay. So question is, in Christ, what do they ask in micro presentation? See, they call it micro presentation, but it is just a topic on which you have to talk. It could be either a current affair topic like tell me something about the pandemic, what steps are taken by the government during the pandemic, or what happened during the lockdown. Or it could be some issue like talk about Article 377, Jammu became union territory. Article 377 was repealed from Jammu. 370 was repealed in Jammu. Or it could be a common, it could be a random topic that is education necessary to become a good businessman? Or it could be a topic like should cricket be made the national sport of India? So either it could be something related to current affairs or it could be a random topic. What is important is, one, you should be able to understand the topic. Second, your communication should be very clear. Whatever you talk should make sense. It should be convincing and they should be able to understand. Right? You will have very little time to speak. You don't have to talk very long. But in that short time, how well you speak is what they are checking. So that's what micro presentation is. Yes, Sharia? Okay. So guys, this is what interview preparation, this is how an interview preparation starts, right? Go to the college website, find everything you can about the college, and then answer the 3 questions. What will you say if somebody asks you about yourself, why you want to do a particular course that you are applying for? And third, why do you want to select this college for your education? If you're able to answer these three questions, then most of the interview is taken care of. Then it could be questions of GK, questions from the subjects that you studied in 11th and 12th, right? Those questions you are already prepared for, but these are the three main questions which you have to start preparing for. So guys, if there are any more questions that you want to ask, then you can hang around. You may ask, I'll try to answer as many as I can. Else, we are done for the day. You may exit the session. Have a good day and stay safe.